Good morning. I want to welcome you to class today. This is our introductory course to Christian counseling. I'm not real sure what week we're in. I think it's the seventh week, but don't hold me there. Sixth or seventh week. We'll have to sort all of that out later. I do know that last week we had barely gotten into lesson number four. And as I recall, that we got stuck in the attending category here. Our four basic communication skills that we're studying are attending, listening, empathy, and probing. Let me just say up front that what we're seeking to do, of course, is to clarify maybe some attributes or characteristics you already have as an effective counselor, or to bring to your attention some things that are very necessary. We're talking about very basic skills. Now, some of these may seem so common, or you may assume to be something that everybody possesses, but that's not necessarily true. I mean, if you're involved in a counseling relationship, and that's what it is a relationship. We have to understand it's a relationship, and just like any other relationship, you have to develop that relationship. If you are going to a friend as a counselor to get some advice or to get some godly counsel, you already basically have a relationship. When you get into what I would call more in-depth counseling, I'm not real sure that friends can serve that purpose. And let me just clarify what I'm saying. There is what is known as a conflict of interest in counseling, or that could be the same thing true in many other fields. A medical doctor, as a general rule, does not ethically treat his own family. I say ethically, there's certainly no reason why he couldn't legally. And I suppose the whole idea is that you may get too involved emotionally, or you may not be as objective as you ought. And of course, if you were in a situation such as that, you certainly would want to confide in another professional, or to work in agreement with another professional. But I think sometimes for example, a professional counselor, and again, we've made a distinction, I think, between what we may consider to be a lay counselor and a professional counselor. A lay counselor could be just friend to friend. It could be a coffee cup counseling across the table from one another. It could be informal counseling. In other words, you're not sitting down in a formal setting, and you're not going about exploring the problem in a systematic way. So we do have to make a distinction there between professional counseling and lay counseling. So when you get into professional counseling, again, you have what we call conflict of interest. And as a general rule, you probably should not enter into a counseling relationship with someone that you're real close to. Now, that would certainly be contingent on a lot of circumstances. Now, probably in contrast to that approach would be pastoral counseling. That pastoral counseling per se could be looked at from two points of view. Number one would be a pastor who just happens to counsel, or it could be a professionally trained individual who majors in pastoral counseling. In other words, a lot of larger churches will have, say, like a counseling center. They'll have a Christian counseling center, and the person who is involved in the counseling are oftentimes, quote, professional. And then again, on the other hand, you may have a pastor who is just simply ministering to his parishioners. So when you are involved, say, in pastoral counseling, especially on a more personal level, you would like to think that the pastor that you're counseling with has a relationship with you. I'm saying in terms of relationship. And if you already have a relationship, again, you may be limited in how much in-depth counseling you can do. And let me just say this just right up front. Don't even think in terms of considering yourself to be a professional counselor unless you're trained in that direction. Don't even think in terms of that. Just think in terms of helping people. And that's one of the reasons why that we're referring to the counselor as a helper and the counselee as a helpee, because it's all talking about helping. So you don't have to think, well, I can't counsel you, you know, because we're too close. Now, if you are dealing, and I think that you've kind of shared with me a little bit about a relationship, that if this individual had a serious psychological problem, then you would recognize your limitation and you would say, I think you need to seek, you know, for further help. So I hope that I'm clarifying, you know, the various relationships that we can have. And again, a lot of times all people really need is a listening ear. Sometimes they just need someone to bounce issues off of, and sometimes they just need someone to show some concern for them, to show some love. I'm thinking about this past week, of course, we had a tragedy in our church, and Bishop was making mention about this individual who was so involved in listening to other people that he would be so attentive to them and would communicate to them that he was interested in what they had to say, regardless of whether it was an ongoing repeating. In fact, he talked about this man was so gentle and he was so patient. And he would listen to this one individual that would corner him almost about every service and would go through the same routine of whining and, you know, complaining and just a repeat cycle. And he would still patiently listen to this individual. And people need that. But then again, and we'll deal with this when we're talking about confrontation, sometimes you just have to say, maybe as a friend, or you may say as a spiritual leader, now we've been around this mountain, you know, several times. Maybe we need to think about moving on, or let's get this issue out and deal with it. You know, the same thing is true in people who keep recalling the past and the hurts of the past. And oftentimes people will carry those hurts and will never express them. And on the outside, it may appear that everything's okay, but on the inside, it's just eating them alive. Now, it's healthy for that individual to come to the recognition that they have to open up, they have to verbalize, they have to express what's on the inside of them in order for them to be helped properly. And so it's left up to the helper to listen with respect, to give attention to what this person has to say. And you know, the first time a person presents it, there may be an outpouring of emotions. And the whole thing there is to empathize with that individual and to seek to feel what they're feeling. And if there's an outpouring of emotion, you're not necessarily looking to solve a problem. You're going to deal with the immediate issue, and the immediate issue is what that person is feeling at the time. We'll be talking about behaviors and feelings in just a moment, but the important thing is to help that individual to move through their emotions. And then, at some appropriate time, after you feel like, through whatever time allotment that's required for you to feel like that there's any type of resolution to the problem, you would have to come to the point, especially as a Christian counselor, to say that at this point in time, we have to turn this over to God. Let's lay it on the altar. Let's commit it to God and move on. Now, a lot of people don't understand the terminology, laying something on the altar. But when you lay something on the altar, that just simply means you have committed it to God. And you don't go and pick it back up. I know parents sometimes say, well, you know, I've laid my child on the altar. That means that you have totally trusted God, that you have committed that child to God. You're going to take your hands off. You're going to let God deal with it. But then when we start interfering, we're taking that person off the altar. So there comes a time that you just have to say, well, there are things that we have to bring closure to, and we have to commit this to God, and let's move on. I know that there have been a lot of injustices that have been done over the past 200 or 300 years racially in this country. And I don't know whether you were here on Friday night or not when the man of God from Trinidad spoke. And of course, he being a man of color, was able to say this and for it to be accepted more so than, say, I, you know, as a Caucasian would speak. And he said something to the effect that if you really look at the sovereignty of God, I'm going somewhere here, so don't think we're getting off of our topic. But if you really believe in the sovereignty of God, you have to believe that really, what we think sometimes is a disaster may be in the plan and the purpose of God. Not that God ordained slavery, but, you know, for whatever reason, and I'm not in any position to determine whether the people were taken against their will was because of anything that was in their life or anything that was wrong. But God has an overall plan and a purpose that we don't understand. And the point he was making was that had my ancestors not been brought over to this country had they not been introduced to the true and the living God, we may still be over in our homeland bowing down to idols and worshiping false gods. Well, I thought that was a very good point. And one of the things that he said was basically that, you know, there comes a time that you're going to have to quit blaming your past. You're going to have to come to the realization that there have been some wrongs committed, there have been some injustices, and oftentimes we maybe, it doesn't make any difference what race, that we have been dealt what we think is a bad hand, that we have not been given a fair shake in life, or that something beyond our control has intervened. And there comes a time that you had to quit whining, quit crying, and just say what is important is from this point on.
Maturity in Christ.
And it all comes through awareness. It has to be, and that's what counseling is. Oftentimes counseling is just simply awareness that, maybe a person is dealing with inner anger. They may be dealing with emotional issues that they're not even really aware of, or they may not even be aware of the root problem. And so, yes, and maturity in Christ begins with awareness and then doing something about what you're aware of and just committing it to the Lord. So in talking about basic counseling skills, we are talking about relationships. That's really the essence of what I've sought to establish. And in a relationship, again, you have two types of relationships. you have one relationship that is maybe already intact before you enter into a helping situation. And again, that would be friend to friend. And then you have a relationship that has to be developed from point A. You, from the very beginning, the whole intent is to develop that relationship, and that relationship is developed through certain skills that you have to have. And the bottom line is that you have to communicate to the person that you're seeking to help, that you're interested, that you're totally interested in that person, you respect that person, you're real, you're genuine. And what we're talking about here, what we talked about last week, were basic communication skills. Communication is not just talking. Communication is not always verbal. In fact, the most effective communication is nonverbal. So what do we mean by attending? Attending just simply means being with. You can think in terms of giving attention to, attending, or focusing on that individual, but the intent is to be with that individual both physically and psychologically. Now, look over into, this is in our manual here. Effective attending, this is on page 20. Effective attending then does two things. It lets the seeker know you're with him or her, and therefore it helps establish good rapport, which of course leads into a good relationship. And then secondly, puts you in a position of being an effective listener. Attending can be considered from three different perspectives, or what we may call successively deeper levels. So if you'll take note here, you got level one, which involves the skills involved in attending, and this is the most superficial level of attending, but at least gives you a starting point, and we'll give this more attention. But look over on the next page, level two, a little bit. See, first, the first level is the lowest level of just seeking to tune in. And then you get a little bit more sophisticated in level two, and you take in consideration the body. This is when you get into the nonverbal communication. And level three is the quality of your presence to your seeker. And that would be a much more involved and much more intimate position. Let's take a look at the first level, and again, level one may be what we call the most superficial, but it's a starting point, and it does involve a lot of just little things sometimes that we take for granted. I think that one thing that we seek to do as a counselor is to be as relaxed as we possibly can. We want the person whom we're helping to be as comfortable as they can, to be relaxed, but don't overdo it. In other words, if I were just simply engaged in a friendly conversation with one of my friends, you might just be slouched out on the couch, or you know, you may just be laid back. I want to be careful what I say here. I have been in counseling situation. I've been in a situation where you've worked as a team, okay? And then of course sometimes you know, maybe if there are two people that work together, and well, I'll just go ahead and say it. This is part of being open, okay? And this is not intended to be discrepant toward my wife. But we've done a lot of marital counseling together. And, of course, she has something that she can offer. One of the things that she can offer, especially when you're counseling a female individual, is that that person to whom you're seeking to help will feel maybe more comfortable with the person of the same sex, because they may say, well, you know, they understand where I'm coming from. There are a lot of things that they can serve the purpose of, just their presence. And certainly if for example, my wife does not take a real lead role in counseling, she certainly is going to interject some very important things. And that's usually the way it works with us. And I suppose my wife, whether I'm professionally trained and people think in terms of me as being the counselor or whatever reason, but I can just say this, that my wife is a very effective counselor one-on-one, and she comes across being very real, very genuine, very concerned, very compassionate, and all those things, and people trust her. But again, I'm not saying this as anything that would discredit her, and it's been many years ago. But I remember one particular counseling session that I got so distracted because we were counseling in our living room. In fact, where we were pastoring at the time, that was really the only place that we counseled. We had our living room that was very private. And I remember this one particular time that she was just kind of slumped over, you know, on the couch and just was really too laid back in a way. And again, there, maybe that would not be as big an issue if you're, say, talking friend to friend. But if you're in serious counseling, and it's just something I brought to her attention, you know, sometimes you may go in the boss's office or you may go in the pastor's office, and you may not be involved in any deep conversation. And I don't know. I guess pastors put their feet up on the desk. I don't know. Bosses do, I know. But that's a little bit too casual and a little bit too laid back. So, you know, sometimes we just have to go through the routine of addressing some things that maybe sometimes you ought to just simply accept as just being natural. But let's use the acronym SOLAR, S-O-L-A-R. Of course, an acronym is a word in which each letter represents another word or another thought. SOLAR, S-O-L-A-R. And the purpose of acronyms, of course, is that it is usually something that's catchy or something you can remember, and it'll help you to recall what it stands for. S-O-L-A-R. S, face the seeker squarely. Squarely. That means to adopt a posture that indicates your involvement. Now, on each of these, I think that we're probably going to be addressing these particular skills to the North American culture. And the reason why we make that qualification is because that what may be natural and normal in our culture may not be in another culture. Let me just give you a quick example. There are cultures in which for an individual to look you straight in the eye would not be showing proper respect. And my understanding is that this is pretty much descriptive of Orientals, that, and especially if you're talking about a younger person, that when if you look an older person straight in the eye, it's not considered to be respectful. Another thing that's going to be different from culture to culture is how you touch, how appropriate touching is. Another thing that's going to be different from culture to culture is going to be what we call closeness, proximity. what is considered to be a proper distance that would indicate your involvement or non-involvement, or if you get too close, you invade that other person's territory, so to speak. You get up into someone's face, and there are cultures where apparently people communicate, you know, almost face to face, maybe a foot apart. Well, every culture is different, so we're going to qualify what we're talking about here from the North American culture. In North America, facing another person squarely is often considered to be a basic posture of involvement. Now, in some cultures, that might indicate confrontedness. That may indicate that you are being confronted, and it could communicate to the other person that that you're on the attack, or this other person is put on the defensive. But it usually says, I'm available for you, I choose to be with you. Turning your back, your body away from another person while you talk to him or her can lessen your degree of contact with that person. One of my pet peeves is, well, I've got a lot of pet peeves, and a couple of them I'll share with you. One of my pet peeves is when I'm talking on telephone and someone says, hold on, you know, and they answer. If you're expecting a call, that's one thing. But just, you know, if you're involved in a conversation with someone and then they put you on hold so they can talk to somebody else is disrespectful to me. And I've had, and I've only done this with people, you know, that have been close to me. There have been times I'd hang up.
Me too.
You know, I mean, I'm not going to sit there for 5 or 10 minutes waiting on them to come back, and I'll just wait on them to call me back. Well, that's one of my pet peeves. But one thing that really bothers me is if you